Thanks, Bill. I actually work for a new employer now, which has changed since the slides went in. I work for Northern Trust. How many people were at my 8 o'clock session this morning? Nobody. So how many of you? Oh, one. Wow. So how many were out really late last night and didn't get up till after 10 today? So is that the group I have here this afternoon? Well, good. Well, I'm glad you're here. I hope we have a little fun today. And my intention is to give you enough information that you can take back to your organizations if you don't have a phishing program to help set it up, and what those things are to look at to do. And we'll cram as much of that into 45 minutes as we can. There's some stats, some things in here, some things that you can use to help convince your own management of the need for this. So we're going to look at four different areas. What's the phishing threat today? What hidden costs there are around the phishing? So we'll talk a little bit about those costs. And then we'll talk about the changing nature of security awareness programs today and how we need to change our thinking and how we do those. And I'm also going to walk through a case study. I'm not promoting any particular vendor. I'll talk about a couple different vendors here. You'll see that we went through in the analysis. But really, it's a case study as far as what we found out and some things that we learned along the way in rolling out a phishing program. Some things that you should be able to take back with you. So let's look at the threat today. This is from the Verizon report, that our threat vector of our person line is actually trending upward. As you can see, that line, that is the attack surface of the person. Servers are coming down a little bit, but they're still pretty high as an attack service surface because there's obviously a lot of information there. And user devices are also going up. So why is this? We've got the movement to the cloud has dispersed the centralized control of data storage, so we're putting our data everywhere. We have shadow IT that creates systems without the rigor of the IT development, so we have code that isn't quite as secure as it should be. We're always connected. We want to work in Starbucks. We want to work everywhere. We want to work from home. And just the rapid change of technology has put more pressure for decision-making on our end users. So I think we should go fishing. So let's go fishing now. So we need to put on a fishing hat. So, oh wait, that's the wrong hat. That's not the right hat. We'll put on this hat, fishing. And we need some good fishing. We need some fishing tools with us today. So I brought my tackle box. And in my tackle box here, let's see. I've got, I need my fishing rod. We're gonna fish. If I can do this without bringing everything out of there. See, everybody has one of these, right? Oop. So, you know, and I just want you to know, you can still buy these today. They still actually sell these. If you go over to your local, thank you, I lost a fish there. Thank you. And if you go over to your local Ace Hardware store, they actually have the Ronco Pocket Fisherman. That you can use to fish with. But this is where you can win some valuable prizes today, okay? I have some prizes. You can win, I have this rare, because there's only one in this room. I have this rare fish bottle opener that you can win, okay? So what's your next question? How? Very good. Very good question. So you win this by, I have some goldfish. I'm going to put in a bag. I have some more goldfish I'm going to put in a bag. I also have some Swedish fish I'm going to put in a bag. And now on the bottoms of these items, on my Swedish fish, there's a little smiley face, a red smiley face on the bottom of one of the Swedish fish boxes. So what's your chances of winning if you drew the Swedish fish? I know. This is a security conference. You're really scaring me now. You people are protecting information. You got five Swedish fish. On one of the boxes, there's a chance of a smiley face. What's the percentage of winning? Oh, you will. Oh, you're going to fish me. Well, I think that's worth a draw right there for that. So, and on the goldfish, just so you know, the goldfish, I have four goldfish, and on two goldfish, I have a smiley face. So what are your chances of winning if you pick the goldfish? 40%? What did you say? 40%? Anybody? What's your name?
John.
John. If you need a good security guy, right here. 40%. So what's the right number? 50%. Right. Okay. So that's your odds of winning. All right. But it's only the first one that draws. So take your pick. You want goldfish or you want Swedish fish? Or if you just want the candy, what'd you get?
Smiley fish.
But it's not red.
Oh, that's red. It's gotta be red.
It's not red. But you got some Swedish fish. So no. Okay, now we see how this works here. All right. So I may have a question or you may have a comment and we'll try to get through all the material. We really will. But these slides are available to you so that you can use this information to help sell your programs. We've got 85% of the exploits are through the top 10 vulnerabilities, but we still have over 900 vulnerabilities that are being exploited. A lot of the malware is still exploiting this stuff. If we look at last year's breaches, 89% of the breaches had a financial or espionage motive. The time to compromise was in minutes in 81.9% of the cases. The time to data exfiltration, 7.1 seconds, or 7.1% in seconds, 21.2% in minutes, 2.5% hours, 67.8% in days. So, as we look at, so what percentage do you think people actually click on a link when they get the phishing, according to Verizon? And I'll have some numbers in the case study later of what we found. What percent? 30%. Did you read the slide that fast? Because you're absolutely right. Here, you get to draw here.
Red one?
What'd you get? What color? What's on the bottom? A red smiley face. There you go. You won. Let's give him a big hand. You won the big prize. What did I do with it? Oh, there it is. Thanks. You won. If anybody has a beer later and you need it to be open, just go see this guy over here. Okay. 12% clicked on the attachment. Okay? The first user, and we're going to talk about why your numbers may be different. You may get different results. The first user in a phishing campaign took 1 minute and 40 seconds. So it's that user that clicks on everything, right? That's all the time it takes, on average, for one user to click on that. That's why these are so important. So do alarms go off in your organizations when this happens? You have a little alarm that goes off, says, I clicked the phishing thing? That doesn't happen to you? Oh, you've got stronger controls, right? Do you have better alarms that go off? Oh, it's not working. Oh, my alerts aren't working. Oh. Well, this is why defense in depth is really an important thing, right? Because when that doesn't work, then we really have to get attention. We really have to have the alarms go off. So when those alarms don't work, then you got to go to drastic measures. Because we have a user that clicked on a fish. Do you know that? Do you know this user just clicked on a fish? Did you hear that the user clicked on a fish? Yeah, were you paying attention to that user that clicked on that fish? Is your IT support now going to do something about that? No. Right? So these things come along, and they come along fast. So we have to train these users to do the right thing. And here's where the costs are around phishing. The annual cost of the contained malware, $1.8 million. When we start adding up all the costs of documenting, of going through the investigation, of evaluating all the intelligence, doing the planning, doing the investigation, that all adds up. So if our malware costs $1.89 million a year because of our malware, and we figured that 11% is due to phishing as planting the malware in the system, that gives you a cost of $208,000 a year. It's pretty quick justification to get to implementing a phishing program. The total costs, though, exceed 3.77, and this is according to the Poneman Institute research of containing the, because you've got the contained malware, you have the malware that you didn't contain that has a cost to it, you have productivity impacts in the organization, and you have credential losses that have also happened through those phishing attempts, showing that a 64% savings in your organization. And there's a report out there that you can get pretty easily that Poneman details that out, savings by phishing. We've also seen, we had the 3.1 billion in business emails transfers to 79 countries, 22,000 victims. That's a lot of money that goes. I know, talking to a Secret Service agent, they said, once it gets past this 24-hour period, the money is just gone. There's no way they can in the banking system can even get it back for you. So we need to change the way that we look at security awareness programs. So, programs usually go kind of like this. You have the security guy get up there and talk about don't write the passwords down, and make sure don't use your pet name and spouse's name and social security number, sports team, stuff like that. Don't share them with others. Make them eight characters. I got a typo there, but just kind of ignore that. Don't keep the same one past 60 days. You also got make sure there's no antivirus software, so we're secure and have a firewall, and so you're secure there too. Some of the most serious threats, though, come, other places and stuff. And I got another typo there. I see. It rests with it's not just an IT thing. It's everybody's job. And security doesn't matter if you back up your stuff every day, too. I mean, don't people want to scream when you hear somebody talking like that? Right? I mean, is that an effective security awareness program? And what about the people who are attending these sessions? How are they getting anything out of those sessions at all? So we don't want to do that. There's different themes that we can build security awareness programs around. These are some of those themes that you could build with. But we also have shifting demographics that we have to take into consideration. Traditionalists, those people before the baby boomers, learned by rote memorization, and they studied things. They did extensive study. There were classrooms. The boomers came along. It was more course-based learning and PowerPoint and lectures and workshops. That was the style for learning. Generation Y, much more hands-on. We're talking about the video game generation, where we learn through learning things, CDs, videos, things like that. And then Generation X, mobile iPod, Web 2.0, blogs, e-learning, and having that being very interactive. So we have differences in those generations. We also have rules that say we have to train the whole workforce from top to bottom. We can go into NIST, we can go into every regulation and say this is something we have to do, but in too many organizations, this is just a checkbox, and that's just not very efficient. We have really a different way that we can look at this. We can plan a phishing awareness program. We can assess the knowledge. We can simulate an attack through phishing. We can provide that immediate feedback. And then we can supplement that with websites, emails, and so forth. And then we can enroll them in short attention span interactive training. I mean, we're talking, in 3 years, half of our workforce will be millennial. So think about that. Half of our workforce will be millennial. Very short, wanting things done. We're in a very social and in a very quick, wanting results right away. I mean, where do you go to get most of your information? When you don't have an answer to something, where do you go? Google, right? I mean, that's the first place you go, is you search on something. So that's the mode we're in. So why do we have these training programs that are these, 1-hour PowerPoint training programs? Just not going to be effective. Shorter interactive modules, and I'll show you some of those, are much more effective spread over the time. So we went through an awareness training tool selection. Assembled a global team, put the requirements together, issued an RFP, or an RFI you could do, reviewed the responses, narrowed that list down to 3 vendors. We had the finalists present, and then we scored them. We negotiated our best pricing. We selected them. We obtained sponsor approval and implemented. Not unlike any other product cycle and any other process we should be going through with all of our vendors. So here's some sample questions, and I put these in here because this is really a useful way to evaluate your vendors to go through this. So what languages do you support? And I'm talking about a phishing simulation program and some online training. So the question is, when you say what languages do you support, you need to ask, are you asking about administration or are you asking about the language that's delivered to the end users? In most cases, that language of administration is going to be English, but the language to the end users, we're a global company in 140 countries, rolled out things from French to Spanish to Swedish to Russian, different languages. So if that's important to you, you have to consider that because some of the vendors you will have to pay for that customization yourself. The vendor we went with had those languages out of the box. What imports are handled? How does that work? Do you bring in users by CSV files or is it Active Directory administration? How are the different groups reported on and what metrics are provided? What sort of reporting are you getting out of that? Are the users asked to provide logon password through clear text? How do they have a login to the system? Do you have a ticket that's sent to them or do they have to have a login ID and password, which can also increase your calls to the help desk? What format options are available for the phishing emails? Are you sending out through text or XML, or do you have videos, or do you have nice graphics, or is it text based? Can the emails be staggered? When we issued phishing campaigns, we staggered them over 3 days, and I'll get into some of those differences why you want to do that. But I'll just tell you right now that you want to span weeks as well, because when you roll out the phishing campaign, if somebody's on vacation that week, you don't really want to give them credit for not clicking on the link, right? Because they weren't there. But when you span weeks, you have a better chance of that. But you also want to keep that period short. You want to keep that to about 3 days. That's about it, because word travels, and we'll show you how we did that differently. What facilities are available for Phish reporting? Any integration with the email client? Some of the products have a button with the email client, so that when somebody reports the Phish, you have a facility for them to report. It will give them immediate feedback that this was a Phish that was sent out by your support area. Or if it's not, then it will go to the support area. And then what training modules are available? What ones come right out of the box? Are splash pages available after clicking on the link? And are clickers automatically enrolled in training? So you want to give them some immediate feedback. But when somebody clicks on a bad link, you don't want to send them to a 20-minute training module. Why wouldn't you want to do that? They're not going to do it? What if I just say, I'm going to, now you've got, I direct them right to that link. Yeah. Right. Yeah, you're forcing them into a situation. They might not want to do it. And you're forcing them in, they're in the middle of a project, and now you're saying, oh, well, we want you to take 15, 20 minutes while you're working on this thing that has a deadline at 5 o'clock and it's 4:30 in the afternoon. You don't want to do that. That could be career limiting. Can emails automatically sent to the non-clickers for training? So this is where you want to be able to reward the people that are not clicking on the emails as part of the program as well. But you still want them to have the same level of training. Are mobile devices supported? When I say that, I don't mean just being able to pull up the website of the training through the mobile device. I'm saying, is it written as a mobile app? So it functions as a mobile app. I did training just to test it. I did it on the train. I know it's a weird pun of words there, I guess. But I did on the train on the way home, where Wi-Fi is always kind of spotty and everybody was going to complain. It worked perfectly and got the training done. What is the style, fun or professional, of the training? Does the training have to be completed all at once? And so, here you might have a bank that is a little more conservative, that you don't want to put some of the goofy stuff in there. But I would argue you still do, but that's just me. Or you may want to have the professional look to it. How do domains for the Phish interact with the email scanning software? You've got domains that you need to be whitelisted, so that those domains get through, right? So of your phishing emails, are the repeat offenders identified? And what reports are available for your phishing statistics? So if you've got repeat offenders, are there some reports so you can say, hey, these same people are clicking on these links all the time. Maybe we need to go have a conversation with them, or some Saturday morning training from, 8 to noon about phishing, right? Is the device identified and can the data be exported? Global availability. What about support centers? So, do you have locations around the world that you're also trying to support, so that the people working on systems in that part can happen? So now let's look at the case study. Most people operate under the illusion of invulnerability, imagining that they are too smart to be manipulated, conned, deceived, or influenced. They believe that stupid things only happen to stupid people. Kevin Mitnick, The Art of Intrusion, okay? One of the master social workers, criminal gone good guy side that we know of. So let's just take a quick little look at a video here. Showing just how things just aren't always as they seem.
This is the venue they chose for their fake auditions for an advert for lip balm.
We're hoping that we can use part of this in a national commercial, right? And this is a test on some lip balms that we have over here. Yeah. And these are our models who are going to help us, Roger and Matt.
Okay.
And we have our own lip balm and we have a leading brand.
Okay.
Would you have any problem kissing our models
no.
to test them? You think that was fine?
That would be fine.
Okay. So that this is a blind test, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and put a blindfold
okay.
on. Okay, now can you see anything?
No.
Hold up so you can't even see down.
Okay.
It's completely blind now,
yeah.
right?
Yes.
Okay. Now what I'm going to be looking for in this test is how something makes the lips, okay? The texture. Right, and maybe if you can discern any flavor or not.
Okay.
Have you ever done a kissing test before? Yes. Take one step in. Okay, now I'm going to ask you to pucker up. Pucker up big and lean in just a little bit, okay?
Okay.
All right.
This is kind of what our fishing's like, right? So we started with 9 vendors. And this is the, you notice this is the Gartner quadrant. That is out there now. When we did this, there was no Gartner quadrant. The Gartner quadrant, we did this in June, the Gartner quadrant came out in October. But what this tells me, though, is there's actually a Gartner quadrant. And that should be significant in itself. That one exists for that. So that says this is a real thing now. Have you ever seen like a Gartner quadrant on security awareness before? I don't recall seeing one. It was always kind of a, yeah, you need to do it. There's not big players out there. So it was very interesting. So we started with Sands, FishMe, Fishline, Wombat, which bought ThreatSim, Security Mentor, Rapid7, Teach Privacy, Fishnet, which is now Optive, and Media Pro, and looked at those vendors. And this is where your network comes really in handy, because I reached out to my network and just asked, hey, what different things are people using? And we brought those together. And it turns out that in that magic quadrant, that we had like 8 of the 9 vendors that ended up in the Gartner Magic Quadrant. So I think we were looking at the right ones. We ended up selecting Wombat Security Technologies. Doesn't mean the other ones aren't right for you. It was just right for us. We were a global organization. One of the key things is we needed multiple language support. And I was also looking beyond just phishing, but I also needed the security awareness pieces. I needed that, and the other vendors at the time were good at phishing, or they were good at security awareness, but none of them were good at both. But Wombat then was good at both. Now I know since then they partnered on different things. So you need to establish a plan, and I put this in a slide. This is a plan to lay out the program. So you wanna think, over a year period, what are you going to roll out in terms of phishing? The first step was a cyber assessment. And this is a module that they have 150 questions. There's a little database that you can add your own questions, or you can use their multiple choice questions. And that tells you where are your pain points. So maybe you don't need to train people on something, but you find out where they're really weak and don't answer some of the questions right. Then we did a mock phishing, which gave a 404 error. Now this is, if we go back to those earlier slides where it said 30% of the people open the attachment and 12% click on the link. Well, here's where you have to be careful with the stats that are out there. It depends how you do it. So the first time we put out the phishing campaign, we did a mock 404 error testing. And what I mean by that is we issued the phish, but we instructed our support departments. We gave them the text to say back, thank you for reporting this. We will look into it, period. Okay? And all this user got back was a 404 screen error. Website not found, right? And the reason we did that, why did we do that? What's that? See if they click again? Okay. What other reason could there be?
Baseline.
Baseline? Okay. Why else would we give a 404 error? Yeah. What's that?
See if the users would report it to IT.
See if they'd report it to IT? Good answer. Why else? What am I looking for? What's that? What's they're used to getting? Yeah. See if they could handle errors correctly? Okay, in consideration of time, I'm going to give you another answer. Because what happens when a user clicks on the phish and then you tell them that you were running a phishing simulation? They tell everybody else, right? So then nobody else clicks on it. So it's that communication around the office. So you intentionally, if you really want to see if they're going to click on it, you don't give them any information back. Then the next time we use the teachable moment, and that's where we gave a splash page, said, hey, you shouldn't have clicked here, but it's okay, you're not going to get fired or anything. And then we auto-enroll them in training to be taken later. Remember what I said, don't give them that training right away? So they get 60 seconds of training at that point, and then they get an email that auto-enrolls them in phishing training. And then for mobile, then once we got that culture of, okay, you're gonna get this kind of training, then we could do the mobile, we did a mobile security awareness training module that we rolled out. Then we hit them again with phishing training, and then we hit them again with another phishing. And that was a year's program. And we laid out the dates when we were going to do what in advance. So we knew. We didn't just decide this week we're going to send out a phish. Okay? So we announced the program 30 days in advance. The why, the what, the when, the where, the how. The URL that the training is coming from, because you want them to click on the training. Right? And so you want to rename that URL to something that's coming from inside your company, instead of the standard vendor one, tie it to their home value. You know, hey, we're trying to help you not click on a phish at work, but also at home. Refer to some other materials and get approval from executive leadership in advance. Very important. Now, the reason you do this note is one of the little things that you tell them in there is that we're going to be, training will help increase security knowledge for the workplace at home, covering topics, blah, 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 phishing and email, blah, 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 and so forth. Starting in August, we're going to send out some training awareness modules, knowledge assessments, that was a cyber assessments, and phishing simulations to help protect our client and personal information assets. Okay, here's the deal of this. I told them we're going to phish them. I didn't surprise them with a phish. I told them. Did they read it? Who reads this stuff, right? You know, that's up to them, but I told them, okay? So you give them the why, the when, the where, the how. You tell them the when. And then you send out the link. You refer to the announcement. This is around your training. You give them the reasons for it. And you give them an avenue to report suspicious emails. So we send out those notes. These are what the assessment modules will look like. This is the cybersecurity assessment module. Basic true, false questions. That you can answer and put in place there, okay? And then they get immediate feedback from them. Good job. They get the little positive reinforcement. You get metrics that are captured, things like number of times they answered the question, how many started this but didn't complete it, the metrics, but you can do it by group if you want to do it that way, or questions by category. Now, we collected this. This is very interesting. In a cyber assessment, notice that 95% of people said, identify phishing threats. 90% passed the questions in the quiz. That's an important number. So when we asked them, 90% said, I'm pretty good at that. We'll see how good they are. And so then stage three, you whitelist your domains. These aren't the actual domains of Wombat. They're pretty close. But you can see My Benefits Today, Early Check-In Hotel, Best Banking Online, Internal Check-In Voice, Paychecks, Track My Package Today. But those are all Wombat domains that are sending the emails from. So then we launched a phishing attack. This is the first one. We did an email quota. That was our first one. We sent it out from IT support. That is not our IT support. This came out from the external fake domain. Your mailbox has exceeded the quota limit. Your mailbox, and then you'll see these links here. The mailbox has exceeded the quota limit as set by your email administration group. Click here to check your current email box quota. Check here to request additional storage space. Oh, well, I want to keep getting my email. I need to click this. Well, we gave them four places to click on this email. Okay, every one of those goes back to Wombat. The next one that we used was a shipping order. We sent this one out right after Cyber Monday because people order stuff, right? Oh, yeah, I want to check my package, right? Very nasty, right? So we have all those links are hot links. They all show up as bad phish, right? Then this is what they get. They get the page right away. Immediate understanding. Oops, I shouldn't have clicked here. And then we enroll them in the interactive training, the 10 to 15 minute modules. We also thank and enroll the non-clickers, too. So we say, thank you for not clicking on email, and oh, by the way, we want you to have the same understanding as the rest of the organization, so you're going to take the training anyway. And then we deliver the phishing training via the game modules. You'll see this is Phyllis and Phish. So they have to go through, and they have to, we're a little short on time here, so I'm going to try to get through these, and they'll be around after. And so they have to click on these when they have bad URLs. They play a little game, or you can do the bank type. Hover over the links and then select which is a good link or a bad link. So they get it's gamified. So then you thank them. Here's the results that we had out of 255 users. First one, the blind quota, 52% of this group, which included some senior level people, 52% clicked on the link. The next time, after we had the quarantined, we sent out a quarantine email saying, hey, you got some things in your spam folder, but it wasn't our normal quarantine message, right? They should have known that. 31%, so it dropped because now they're getting the teachable moments. 7% on the gift card because nobody believes the gift cards anymore, not because they're getting better. Shipping logistics, 19%, we're getting better, okay? 14% later, holiday greeting card, getting better. Email quota, again, we repeated it to see what would happen. 18% on the email quota. That is a significant drop. If we can get it from 52 to that, they say, you're not fooling me this time. And then we did a shipping logistics, again, a year later, 12.5%. Okay, those are good numbers. You want to drive those down even more, but those are really good numbers. There's also other phishing controls I've listed in there. There's some propaganda if you want in the bookstore. And here's some final thoughts. We need to plan these things. It needs to be behavioral to stick and bury the once a year training sessions. I'm just going to wrap up with a very short little video.
They're really biting today, Don.
It's all about the lure.
Dude?
And I think it's about time.
Oh, they're really biting today,
Zorik.
It's all about the lure.
Refreshingly smooth Bud Light. Always worth it.
Hey, dude, take my picture.
So think of that tonight when you're at the party. So thank you very much. You've been a great group. Thank you.